You may see the earthquake in Taiwan and think that's really sad, and of course it is that it's happening over there.
Of course.
But it affects the entire global supply chain in a way that is important because we kind of have emptied out to a degree our war chests. This actually really does tie into, you know, you guys know about DEI, right? Diversity, mm-hmm. equity, inclusion, and how it ties to the CHIPS Act, which is about, well, you probably think it's about reducing our dependence on Taiwan for our own chips. Unfortunately, it's an absolute disaster, and it's likely to be exacerbated by this earthquake. And that's the problem, right? Being prepared is not just about being prepared for what happens day to day. It's about being prepared for things that are unpredictable. The more disciplined you are in your day to day, and this also includes us as a nation, then the less fragile we are, the less exposed and vulnerable we are. So you may see the earthquake in Taiwan and think that's really sad, and of course it is that it's happening over there.
Of course.
But it affects the entire global supply chain in a way that is important because we kind of have emptied out to a degree our war chests as it relates to Ukraine. And let me ask you this before we move on to this segment. Do you think that the United States should intercede in a conflict with Taiwan and China? Comment below. I think it's a very different situation than Ukraine and Russia. And I think that there are multiple opinions that are valid. Unfortunately, a lot of opinions out there. My tongue is tired from laughing.
I know.
So I'm mumbling. Unfortunately, a lot of opinions are not based on an understanding of where we are right now and how it affects the United States. Ukraine, Russia does not affect the United States in the same way that Taiwan and China does. And this earthquake, there's a good reason to think that it could accelerate this. So it was a 7.2 magnitude level earthquake. And here's a clip for those of you who haven't been made aware of this. As of right now, 10:30 Eastern, we know of 9 dead, 821 injured, and still at least 127 people trapped. So, of course, man. Our hearts go out to those people, and we hope that they're retrieved from the rubble, as many as humanly possible.
Yeah.
Now, this has had some other ramifications. So, the company when I say this, I don't know which one is better. Taiwan Semiconductor is the name of the company. Not particularly creative. The abbreviation is TSMC. I don't feel like either one is faster to say.
I don't think so. Whichever one you want to go with. You just pick a lane.
It was forced to evacuate and close some of the microchip, right? Some of their plants.
Yeah.
Okay, so let me give you a few key facts here about TSMC. And I just don't know who named it Taiwan Semiconductor. It must be the same person who came up with the Yoplait is so good slogan.
I mean, it's descriptive.
Yeah.
Geographically and also productively.
It's a very literal culture. I believe.
Yes.
What do you do? Semiconductors.
Where?
Where are you? Taiwan. Good enough.
Done.
Okay.
No one has that name yet? Perfect.
We have U.S. Steel. I mean, it's the same kind of thing we had.
No more meeting. So, 61% is what they have of the global market share when we're talking about semiconductors.
One company.
Yeah, one company. 90% of the global market share for advanced chips.
Which is really what you want.
Yes.
You know?
Think about that.
Please give me the 5-generation old one, right?
Yes.
I want the new ones. And they've got 90% of the advanced chip market.
Ideally in a place with the highest likelihood of a tectonic shift taking place.
Or attack by another country because they don't recognize your right to exist.
Exactly. And who do they supply? Apple, Google, Amazon, the United States Department of Defense. I don't know how aware many of you are as to how reliant the United States is on Taiwan specifically. I looked for this. And maybe research can correct me. I don't think there's any other category of business or technology where the United States is more dependent on one single country, let alone one single company. It seems to be the most severe that I've come across.
Yeah.
So here's kind of some important points to keep in mind. Any type of disruption, right, would cause some really serious supply chain issues. So 1999, Taiwan's, that was, I guess, their last major earthquake. it caused a 12% price increase for chips. Okay. All references are available at lighthousecredit.com. So 12% in 1999. Okay. But back in 1999, Taiwan only had 15% of the market share. It's now 61, as I just told you.
It'd be way, way worse.
If you do that math, that could be anywhere from 30-something to 60-something percent of an increase, depending on who you cite.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, just think about the used car market, right? Because all the chips for the new cars weren't coming in. And so the used cars, it almost became like the price of new cars.
Right.
Similar kind of supply chain disruption that you can experience, except obviously with an earthquake, you could actually destroy production capabilities or the capability for somebody to even go to work. Mm-hmm. They can't get there, right?
Yeah.
So massive, massive problem if that...
Well, just to put one number on it, if China were to invade Taiwan, it could cost the global economy $10 trillion, according to Bloomberg News. And so that means that, of course, the United States has had to try and figure out a contingency plan. Now we enter in former Vice President Joe Biden. We have the earthquake today. All right. We quite literally had this segment prepared, I believe, 2 days ago or yesterday because of some of the results that have been coming in from the policies. Well, mainly one, DEI and the CHIPS Act. So I guess DEI is sort of the framework for this CHIPS Act. You would think CHIPS Act, okay, we're trying to reduce our dependence on Taiwan for semiconductors, for chips. This would have catastrophic results for the economy. We need to accelerate this as quickly as possible where we can start creating these onshore. You wouldn't think, all right, hiring blacks, women, and LGBTQ is a central component of this. However, late March, Joseph R. Biden was in Chandler, Arizona, to discuss and brag regarding the new investment as part of his landmark CHIPS Act.
Today, Pat is building here on another field of dreams. I'm thrilled to announce the latest public-private partnership and one of the largest investments in semiconductors in the United States ever.
And also, should be noted, a huge Eric Estrada fan, former Vice President Biden, thinks it's a bill to reinstate the show CHIPS and hopes to get a guest role in the reboot.
It just looks lost.
Sidecar Joe.
like those little pictures of bulldogs and sidecars.
Oh, yeah,
only
yeah.
The former vice president.
That's exactly what that is.
He's a bulldog.
A bulldog behind the bike rack.
He's an American bulldog.
What? I had to be delivered by C-section. What? So, what this CHIPS Act does, it commits to what they will claim, okay? $52 billion in funding research and subsidies for chip makers, right? It offers a 25% investment tax credit for people who invest in semiconductor manufacturing, to some degree here in the United States.
That all sounds fantastic,
It all
right?
sounds good, right? But let's go through what this actually looks like and how DEI has infected this and ruined it, where it's now just more wasted money. A good example would be, remember you thought, okay, investing in new forms of energy, good, until you realize that it came with the caveat, has to go to green energy like Solyndra Solar, and it was just a giant waste of money. That's what we're seeing right now with the CHIPS Act because of the additional layer of diversity, equity, inclusion, which has nothing to do with manufacturing chips. So let's go through their claim. The claim that the CHIPS Act is going to make America a leading producer of semiconductors, of chips by 2030. Okay. Here's the truth. No. It's not even in the realm of possibility with the caveats that come with the CHIPS Act. So you hear chips, great. Let's start creating these ourselves. Let's reduce our dependence. However, 2030, now they put a number on it. It's not even close to the realm of possibility. Let's just look at the rollout of funds right now. Currently, 600 companies have applied. That's good. There have been only 9 grants awarded to 4 companies total.
Wow. Yikes.
That's how slow the rollout is right now. The government is not designed to function efficiently, and it's exacerbated when you add in DEI and you add in ESG, which of course is the cause du jour of this administration. So let's go through this other claim, right, that they obviously have to make. That actually, hold on a second, DEI, diversity, equity, inclusion, is great. For American industry, this comes from the White House themselves, not Casablanca.
Higher performing organizations, huh? Through DEI?
Yeah. It's the only time that someone can claim higher performance using a metric that has nothing to do with performance.
Yeah, exactly. And what studies are you citing?
Yeah.
Just it's like when you're playing dodgeball and you go, I picked the black kid for no particular reason at all.
None.
Yeah. Well, if it's a sport.
What would you do that for?
Yeah. Unless you're looking at a swimming pool. So
he's black?
The truth is DEI is in fact, killing the CHIPS Act in a very quantifiable way. Let's look at the DEI stipulations and the red tape as it relates to the CHIPS Act. Here you go. Here's from, I believe these are from the different sections, 19. There are sections aimed
at... There are 19 sections aimed at.
Well, this is section 19, I believe, from the CHIPS Act. There's sections, or are there 19 sections? Or this from 19 sections?
Yeah. No, there are 19 sections aimed at benefiting minority groups.
Okay.
19 different sections of this stupid act.
Then there are 13 uses of the word diverse or diversity.
Yeah.
There are 6 uses of the word inclusive. And of course, there's one big giant requirement that the companies prioritize union labor.
Ah.
And we'll get to the donations
in
a second. Yeah. And by the way, this is kneecapping the United States.
Yeah.
Not only does this kneecap the United States, not only would this have catastrophic results if something happened with Taiwan, but it also forces us into more wars. You need to understand that. Our reliance on other nations forces us into more wars because their fights, unfortunately, become our fights. Now you have an administration who will engage in fights that are not our fights. But it does happen. If you can't have a smartphone, if you can't have any new cars, if your entire company goes down because effectively your computers don't work, the tech that you have can no longer function, guess what? You have to put some boots in the ground to help protect Taiwan. We need to reduce our dependence. Let me give you some excerpts from the bill. This is from Section 104. It says, the Department of Commerce shall establish activities within the financial assistance program relating to inclusion of economically disadvantaged individuals, minority-owned businesses, veteran-owned businesses, and women-owned businesses.
Well, hold on. I thought the whole thing was to make sure that we were independent. Like,
yes.
None of this is one of those cases where it is, I guess, a national security threat, right? So what you would think people would do is just do the very fastest, best way, best path to get to chip independence and let the market sort that out. The winners will win. And the people that don't have enough DEI, apparently, because DEI leads to higher performance, they'll lose.
Right.
And you won't even have to do anything.
Right.
And apparently, women-owned businesses, veteran-owned businesses, I can't remember what...
Minority-owned businesses.
Economically disadvantaged businesses.
Yeah.
They'll do better, too, because apparently all those things are good, positive things that'll help us produce chips.
Well, think about this, too. You already have a problem, right? A supply issue. And you're saying, okay, we now have this investment in infrastructure. Right. You now have to draw from a pool of businesses that is a very small fraction of what would be available. Why?
Yes.
Because it's not owned by a woman. Okay, how many women own the appropriate businesses in the tech industry that could help contribute to manufacturing chips? Doesn't matter. You have to have a certain amount of women. It's the same thing with, it's not that female, we've used this analogy before, it's not that female comedians can't be funny. That's not true. There are plenty of female comics throughout history have been funny. I shouldn't say plenty. There are some. The reason you have a problem.
There's plenty, come on.
I mean, there's plenty... It's a relative term, but there are far fewer women who go into stand-up comedy than men. That's just as far as the entry point. However, I have been to many shows, and I'm sure you have too, where they go, this is a showcase show. We have, I don't know, we have 8 comics. Half of them have to be women. Okay, half of them have to be women, but you're drawing from a pool where only 20% of the people who have entered are women. So what you see are far more mediocre female comics with specials who are broadcast because they're drawing from a shallower talent pool. Now, what does that do? That shortchanges the people like the Kathleen Madigans, like the Joan Rivers of the world, because there are a lot of mediocre female comics who get a push because they say we need to hit a minimum quota of female comics, and that's why people say female comics aren't funny. It's really the fault of the industry and the bookers. Men don't get that. And by the way, they don't do it with black guys either, unfortunately, in comedy, because there are a lot of black comedians. If you look throughout history, they are disproportionately represented because they're very, very funny. You look at Richard Pryor, you look at Eddie Murphy, you look at Dave Chappelle, you look at Chris Rock. You're going to fill out that top, right now, Kevin Hart, Cat Williams. You're going to fill out in any given year the top 10 comics touring with more than half very likely being black comedians. It doesn't need DEI. It does, unfortunately, get incorporated in comedy with women. And so people see it and say, women can't be funny. So right now, apply that to semiconductors. Apply it to chipsets. Apply it to, has to come from a female business. For a very long time, people are going to say, yeah, women can't make chips. And some can. Unfortunately, you demanded that more women do it, and they just weren't capable, or minority-owned businesses. So here's something else, a fact sheet on the CHIPS Act. It says, recruiting, training, and retaining a large, skilled, and diverse workforce will be critical to strengthening the U.S. semiconductor ecosystem. Can someone please comment if there's something I'm missing as it relates to performance issues and being able to create semiconductors? how is diversity relevant? I can't think of anything less relevant. This would have to be 100% performance-based. Yes? No? Just apply it to your surgeon.
I'd also imagine that a lot of the people in the field working in this field of semiconductors and chip creation are not white.
Yes, I would imagine that as well.
I mean, it's a great field to go into. A lot of people are doing it. A lot of people are go to school abroad or coming here for that.
Right.
I mean, look at Simi Valley, and I mean, it's not white city. I mean, kind of, but
Silicon
Valley.
Yeah, that's what
Simi Valley is very white.
Yeah. I live there. What's that? What's the difference?
That's right outside of L.A. It's just north.
Oh, that's what I'm thinking.
That's pretty white.
Yeah, that's where a lot of porn people live, I heard.
Yes, it is true. All Chatsworth. Right.
Yeah, I'm thinking of the other one.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
I think. The point remains, and we'll be talking about Shakira later on. This is just I just want to reread this. Large, great, skilled, great, diverse workforce. It's just another example of former Vice President Biden's regime pushing a woke agenda, of course, and harming the United States.
On DPI, you know the chips will die, and we're starting to feel it more. Resistors, conductors, you could say Joe really fucked us.
Oh, Biden!
I didn't know how to get to it because the Shakira feminism segment is later.
That was a quick turn.
But it was teaser. Related.
It's a little teaser.
It's, you know, yeah.
It is.
It's a taste. And then we'll have a middle segment that'll be like a sorbet, a palate cleanse. All right, let's go on to another claim that you will see here to justify this horrible policy that will not improve the United States' independence as it relates to semiconductors. They say, or at least this former vice president, the administration, labor unions are the ones, and that's the reason for this little back door in the bill. Labor unions built America.
Wall Street didn't build America. They're not bad guys. They didn't build it, though. The middle class built the country, and unions built the middle class.
So here's the truth. Unions are kneecapping chip makers, to be clear. And it, again, in a very quantifiable way, these issues can be measured. So companies like TSMC, they can't hire skilled workers.
Shares in TSMC slumped more than 3% on Friday after the world's largest chipmaker predicted a 10% drop in 2023 sales, and it said that production at its plant in the U.S. would be delayed. The factory in Arizona was supposed to be operational by late 2024, but the company says a shortage of skilled workers means production won't start until 2025. That plant is supposed to make advanced chips for tech giant Apple. TSMC says it will send experts from Taiwan to the U.S. to train local workers.
By the way, that is totally that guy's equivalent of black comedians doing white guy voice.
Yes.
He does not talk like that when he is not on air. And here in Taiwan, we have right now semiconductor. Okay. He's totally putting that on. You can comment if you agree, and you can, if there still was a dislike button.
I think he's doing a good job, though.
He's doing a good job.
What? I'll be honest, I appreciated it.
Yes, yeah. I appreciate it, because I feel like he relates to me.
Yeah.
So.
Thanks for making me understand.
Oh, that's not a guy.
So the labor unions, by the way, they complained after TSMC flew in 500 Taiwanese workers to speed up the work.
Of course they would.
Yes, they complained.
Like, you're going to complain because people who know how to do this really, really, really well come in and try to teach you how to do it?
Yes, exactly.
It's like the movie Gung Ho all over again.
Yeah, exactly. I forgot about that film.
Yeah.
Yes, deep cut. I will say this. Think about this. Okay, we need to build more chips. All right, we need to build more semiconductors.
Uh-huh,
okay,
yeah.
We have a problem. We have to accelerate this. We want to hit our numbers by 2030. Okay, great. We need to bring in the best people. Well, hold on a second. A certain percentage has to be black. All right, that, okay.
Not a lot of black
that
guys.
That cuts them out. Okay, certain percent of them have to be from women-owned businesses. Okay, all right. So now we're left with a pool of, let's say, 25% of the... okay, can we get this done by 23? They've got to be union. I don't know what the crossover is of union and minority-owned and women-owned, but this is why government can't be efficient, because you have different lobbying groups who come in and say, let me get in on that action, and by the end of it, none of it makes sense. By the way, in case you're wondering, why would this include labor unions? Well, you may not know this. People talk about big oil and Wall Street like they do, this whole kind of class warfare. 13 of the top political donors, I guess 13 out of 25 of all time, are unions. And 90% at least of their political contributions go to Democrats. It's not even close. And a lot of them are basically funded by taxpayers, because a lot of them are public sector unions.
Yeah.
And a lot of them, obviously, they don't ask their members who they would support politically. So really, you're looking at some of the biggest donations that have taken place throughout American history in the hands of a few key union heads across this country. That's what funds your political campaigns.
Yeah, and basically, it's not just bad big unions. That's part of it, but it's bad big companies.
Right.
Because we've talked about this before. Regulation is not the enemy of a large company that can handle it, right? They can afford to pay the lawyers. They can afford to pay people right. to be regulated. Mom and pops don't have enough people on staff to handle this kind of stuff. Now, mom and pop is not going to build a chip factory the way you're thinking of it, but look at a smaller business that is trying to enter into this space. There's plenty of smaller businesses trying to enter this space and going, we can't handle all of this regulation. Of course not. We can't do all of these things. So it seems like this legislation is not just kickbacks to the unions. It's also kickbacks to these companies.
Big companies.
Because they can handle all of that.
Right.
And it just seems like this legislation is crafted for them because there's no other reason to have these kinds of metrics that don't have anything to do with performance when you're talking technology especially.
Right. And it's hard enough to compete in the international marketplace when you're looking at, for example, different wages if you're competing with nations like China without kneecapping ourselves and making it completely untenable to try and do business here in the United States. A big part of that is unions. We've talked about this.
Yeah.
We have these, for example, these mugs. They're etched and they're painted in the United States because we could find people. We could not find a mug manufacturer in the United States who could meet the supply.
No.
There was not one who could do it. And so we had to go abroad to get the mugs and then, you know, use the skilled labor here in the United States. Would be great if we could. It doesn't exist. That's an issue. And that's an issue that is a direct result of policy and, yes, big union influence. It hurts American workers and it hurts the made in America. Unions mean less made in America because it's just not something that you can afford. Let's look at the actual results here. This is kind of fascinating. So TSMC, yeah. We've been talking about this company. They're building a new plant in Japan. Samsung is building another mega project in South Korea. Intel is quite literally building plants in Poland and Israel. Think about this for a second. Our policies here are so bad. We just pledged $52 billion to the CHIPS Act. You would think people would be, they would be coming in droves, right, with these tax incentives. These companies would rather build their plants in countries that are riddled with tsunamis, natural disasters, and are on the brink of nuclear war and or dealing with Hamas. That is more attractive than building a plant in Arizona.
Would you rather build a plant at the Mexican-American border or the DMZ?
Yes.
I'll DMZ, take the DMZ, Bob. Please.
Yeah. To be fair, though, that dry heat.
It's the dry heat, yes.
Yeah. Well, it's the armed guards in the towers that make you feel safe.
Yes. Yeah.
They keep you in.
Just think about that, though. Think of how can we even have a prayer at competing if we have created a policy to basically subsidize an industry, and even after that, the major company throughout all the world, as far as it relates to semiconductors, said, you know what? Okay, Arizona, Michigan, Georgia, we'll go with Japan, tsunamis, earthquakes, South Korea, same, and Israel, Hamas, Poland. When you're talking about right now, the issue, everyone's, I don't believe that's the case. Everyone's saying Russia's going to march on through Poland. They believe that they have better security
yeah.
and can better produce semiconductors in those countries than American states.
Yeah, and probably putting the plant next to the country that is led by the craziest person on the planet,
yes.
North Korea, that has nukes and likes to try and test fire them. Not successfully all the time, by the way.
Right.
Yes. And could nuke Seoul in what? I think it's 15 minutes, maybe less. Like, right. come on. Who's doing the risk-reward math here?
And you wonder, you know, they look at it and they say, well, we just don't want to deal with this. Let me just read you from the U.S. Department of Labor, their Good Jobs Initiative. Mm-hmm. It says, DEIA is a core value and practice norm in the workplace. Hold on a second. What's the A? It was DEI. This just changed. Did it just change this morning? It's now DEIA?
Anal.
No. It's accessibility.
I'm sorry, I've been on different sites.
It's accessibility, equity, inclusion, accessibility.
Like for, is it like for, is. So it's like a wheelchair ramp?
I don't know.
Okay,
probably.
Maybe like
I think they already have to have that.
I would think
ADA
so.
ADA stuff, yeah.
Oh, they just sent me a note here. Thank you, research team. It says, the A is for good jobs are the foundation of an equitable economy that lifts up workers and families. Underserved communities include LGBTQ+ individuals, women and justice-involved individuals, and immigrants. Oh, so it's making it more accessible to LGBTQAIP.
And justice.
And migrants justice and justice.
Involved and immigrants.
Justice-involved individuals? What the
fuck is that?
What have we been doing to hold these things back from them?
Is someone just...
It truly is concerning me. Like they're being held back.
You just gotta add a letter.
You would think that someone is walking into TSMC and just swatting pennies out of the.
Yeah, like they've got a patrol. Yeah. They've got a hall monitor that comes through and goes, "Pride flag on your backpack." I don't think so. You're fired.
Yeah, exactly. What are you?
Doubt it.
What are you? What are you? What are you? Biracial? Or I'm Dominican. Ouch.
Okay. We thought this guy was Cuban. Turns out he's just a light-skinned something else.
This is not going to be accessible for you.
Doesn't make sense.
Think of the fact this has gone through a process. I don't know the cost of just the bill taking place. You were talking about tens of millions of dollars to get $52 billion in subsidies, all for something that doesn't work, where they will set up shop in South Korea and Israel anyway. Your government can't do the job. Do you understand? Even if you believe that they were all inherently good and looking out for you, and they're not, they suck at their job. Nowhere else would people who implement policies like this see any other future other than the unemployment line. So, in conclusion, 61% of all semiconductors, Taiwan. 90% of all advanced semiconductors. Any type of Chinese invasion or some kind of a blockade would decimate the global economy, likely $10 trillion, and the United States can't stop tripping over itself in trying to remedy this problem that needs to be fixed at the very latest by 2030, and even then a lot can happen between now and 2030, but because they have to ramrod in DEIA and a bunch of other red tape stipulations, and they're funded by big labor unions, nothing's going to happen. Congratulations, America, you just wasted $52 billion, at least.
That's a lot of nuts!
Watch Ladder with Crowder live, Monday through Thursday, 10 a.m. Eastern.